It's a very, very, very nice, beautiful evening here in California. After the rain, it's warm. Stars are out. And if you're going to be miserable, you might as well be miserable in California. Okay? I've been miserable my whole life, but at least I have California to keep me company. It's like a friend that says, don't worry, I've got your back. Much love to California, that's for sure. We're getting like an incredibly wet winter, which is just, you know, thank God, thank the atmosphere, which shifted to bring the rain into the state. It's, you know, I'm in tears, you know, just how great it is, because we were facing a catastrophic drought, and I thought it's possible this California couldn't sustain civilization anymore. Life here, I mean, couldn't people? We were basically out of water. We're pumping the Central Valley is, you know, sinking. It's pumped all the water out. We were in a state of severe disaster, and we've just had like almost record, all-time record precipitation this winter so far, and they're getting another massive dose through Santa Barbara, Los Angeles, San Diego, which is great. Especially Santa Barbara, which is the last place in extreme drought. And I believe starting tomorrow, they're going to get like 24 hours of just Pineapple Express, just massive rainfall. So, you know, it's amazing when you think that everything could possibly just turn out horrible and you get saved from it. And I'm in shock about it. I feel guilty to let the water run still. I mean, it's like I'm still conserving, and you know, water most of the time. It's like, oh, you mean I can actually let the water run a little bit? Wow. So it's a very amazing metaphor California's given us. But most people are just sort of oblivious to it. A lot of people in California are not natives here, but as a native here, having been through several droughts before, and then this one, and just realizing, if it doesn't rain, we're history. We're history. And yet, this life-saving rain has come in this winter that nobody predicted. Okay, no one predicted this. And In ancient times, people believed the earth was a reflection of their own thoughts, desires, that it was sacred thus and alive because it was reflecting what we desire for it to reflect. And they were right. And thus, there is no world outside of us, really. There is no external world at all, actually. There is no external world at all. Now, that doesn't mean that my perception is experiencing, I'm experiencing it in here, so that's not quite like that. It just means that it's our the creative imagination of spirit is imagining this world as a way to for us to doubt ourselves, our spirit to doubt itself, as if there's some concretization, there's something outside of the mind that needs the mind to go through a process to change it. Now, this my belief in process is what we call materialism. And we're in like the darkest stages of materialistic culture right now in this world. It's an anathema where we're taught cradle to grave that there's a subjective world that is full of process, and it's so ridiculous, the teachings of materialism. And then we condemn the ancients, like, oh, what fools, you know, thinking that the world was somehow, we were capable of using our mind to get results. People used to pray for rain, they used to pray for this, used to pray, right? And now we just listen to meteorologists who say, well, now we're in a 100-year drought and there's no relief this year. And whoops, gee, it rained. I wonder why it rained. That's weird. Well, maybe because a lot of people prayed that it would rain. Deep down, I certainly did a lot. And I invited the water in, the rain in. I said, and just, you know, talk to the world. Said, it'd be really great. We really need some rain. Send it our way, please. And it's amazing how it's now just covering the whole state. Just beautiful. We're missing the worst of it in this time. Good because we're super saturated. But the Southland's going to get it, and that's going to really help them a lot. And more snowpack. So there's no external world from our mind. It's all just like a dream. And we see like concrete objects in a dream. How many of those concrete objects are self-existent, separate from the dream when we're dreaming? For instance, I just dreamed that I was taking a rest this afternoon because I'm under the weather, kind of, really. And I had this sort of dream that was very interesting, very significant. I can't remember exactly what it was, but then they pointed out and said, here's your surfboard, and they showed me this surfboard. And it was this unadorned surfboard. Most surfboards have decals, labels, color schemes, everything. This is just a white surfboard. Nothing on it at all. No labels at all. And they said, this is your surfboard here. Here you go. And they set up in this beautiful rack, highlighted a beautiful background. I was just like, wow. That's awesome. I looked at it and said, oh, that's just right for me. Just right. Now, is that surfboard in the dream, is that somehow some concrete surfboard that's somehow separate from the dream, that exists as a concrete entity outside the context of a dream? If the dreamer decided that, I want that surfboard to have labels on it, Would the dreamer have to go through a bunch of processes to do that? Like have to dye the surfboard, get chemicals, and then dye the surfboard, and go through all this manufacturing process? Was the surfboard actually manufactured in the dream in the first place? Or can the dreamer just decide how they want they want the surfboard, what color they want it, if they want to change it, just decide and it changes. You know, where's the concrete entities in a dream? Where are they? And it's funny, we dream every night full of just endless supposedly concrete entities. Plants, people, buildings, you know, everything, you name it. And yet we wake up, poof, they're all vanished. Right? All made up, dreamed up. But we don't correlate that with, say, wait a minute, I wonder if this world is like that, actually. And history is replete with those who knew it was a dream and were able to just do what we call miracles, because miracle means there's no process involved, it's just direct. Apex yoga is direct yoga. We're pointing out the direct nature of nature is directly within the context of our mind. Directly so. There's no intermediateness at all. It's always been there. There's nothing that put it there. It arises and subsides directly within the nature of our mind, which is pure freedom of creativity. Now, we're experts at believing in that the dream is has all these qualities. We're experts at doubting that this is so. We're experts at doubting that this is so. But doubting a fact, what does that do to a fact? It doesn't do anything at all. It doesn't do anything at all. Doubting a fact doesn't change a fact at all. So we're in a dream and we think stuff is somehow independent of the dreamer. We doubt that the dream's not real, right? If some of them were to appear in the dream, say, you know what? All the stuff you're seeing, it's just a dream. It's not real, actually. I mean, it's not independent of a dreamer at all. It can be changed on an instant, everything. Wouldn't we doubt the one who's telling us that and say, what? So the figure that's in dreams, the dream figure, is not the dreamer. It may represent the dreamer as a symbol. And the dreamer is just imagining that they are in the dream as the symbol, but they're not. The dreamer is not just a mere symbol in the dream. The dreamer is everything in the dream. I mean, the dreamer is dreaming everything in the dream equally. If you have some protagonist in a dream, that usually you might see yourself. You're in a dream and you're walking around. Stuff's happening. But isn't everything in that dream, like the surfboard in that dream, and the ones who presented it to me, and aren't we all equally part of the dream? Aren't we all equally symbols of a dream? This is why they say it's all one. In this world, everything's equal, all the same. It's all like, just like in a dream. The trees, you're walking along the road. Isn't the road exactly the same, in exactly same position as just being a dream imagination as the trees along the road? And you're walking along the road, some figure walk on the road, aren't they all equally? I mean, what's the difference? You see some water lake, that's a dream lake. So there's no difference at all. No difference at all. Now, I'm doing a very interesting experiment right here, right now. I'm listening to some, I have earbuds and listening to country gospel, some country gospel music by George Jones and Tammy Wynette, and yet I'm taping at the same time, and I'm not finding any trouble or conflict at all doing this. And so I'm saying, is it not possible for us to continue dreaming and yet be aware that we're dreaming? It's all a dream. Now, Jesus says yes. He says when you have true vision, you'll recognize this is all a dream, and we're all, these figures are just, have nothing to do with what we are, what we really are at all. They're just dream figures. It's all a dream. You will see this very clearly, he says. But it won't bother you. And you'll still function here fine. So I'm listening to this awesome, awesome music. At the same time, I'm able to very clearly convey Apex Yoga teaching here. That's extraordinary. I've never tried this before exactly like this. I tried it in the last video, but I would be singing and attention back and forth. But now this time I'm just giving this Apex Yoga teaching video, but in the background is this gorgeous music. So it's possible to experience this gorgeousness and the same hand appear to be perfectly normal to people here in this world in terms of conversing or conveying truth to them, right? And this music is so beautiful, especially as I have it turned way down low. I mean, for me, I know how to pick music. And this is just, gorgeous music. I don't like to shortchange myself in when it comes to music, that is for sure. And thank God I found this music. Most people don't even wouldn't even think of looking there, and I was led to it. So tasteful and gentle and s gorgeous. Peaceful music, but gorgeous music. Got some of the best singers in the world, the best musicians in the world on this, and along with the Beach Boys too. Same thing. This is the A team in Nashville, the musicians, and then you have the background singers are the Nashville Edition and the Jordanaires. The Jordanaires sang on a lot of Elvis's recordings and live with him. And then you have George Jones and Tammy Wynette, two of the best singers ever's been. And the songs are all these beautiful gospel songs, and it's just ridiculously gorgeous music. So it's quite an experience I'm having here. And the music is turned way down, but it's still very clear, very clearly with the earbuds like this. But I can still hear myself talk over it, Yeah. It's an amazing, amazing experiment. I figure, what else? What do I have to lose? People are going for it right now. All right, we're all going for it. So. That's what we're doing here. We're just going for it. What else is there to do right now? All right? What is there to do? Now, I had another amazing experience, and that is the grace of God blocking a certain direction that He says He wants to turn you away from it for now. He says, okay, you've done that, been there, done that. Now, I want you to do something. I want you to up your game even more. And so God's been telling me, hey, enough of the beach for now. Enough of surfing for now. Okay. And I realized that. Wow. So I was, but I said, well, let me just check a little bit magic seaweed, and see what the surf stories are. So I typed in magic seaweed as always, hit return to go to the site, and this page pops up, says 404 on it, and it says page not found, page not found. I said, what? Did it again, nothing, nothing, nothing. I couldn't get through to Magic Seaweed. 404, page not found. Page cannot be reached. I said, wow, you talk about God blocking something. And I got the hint. Okay, so we're backing off of that here. We're backing off of it. But when God closes one door, God opens another. And so I'm not sure what the next door to be opened will be. And I know we've all been through that, right? It's bound to be better. Now, that's astonishing because the time I had at the beach this autumn and winter was just, I can't even put it into words, actually. I really cannot. Unforgettable. You might say unforgettable. That's why I want to keep going back, but God said, not enough. There's something even better for you. I said, well, something better. Oh, wow. That's amazing. So I'm going to find out what's even better than that. I'm not used to being not feeling well. So I tend to just kind of, ignore it and just like we all do and just but it hasn't stopped the momentum at all. And that is that we're all going for it right now. Again, my friend has what we call cancer, is experiencing what we call cancer. And he said, well, I've got, at least I have a little bit of time to prepare, for the transmigration, my migrate out of this world. I would say, well, yes, but not so fast, because again, he has nothing to lose at this point. Maybe God will block the cancer, just like God blocked me to go to the beach. God would say, okay, enough of that. When God says enough of something, and you allow God's grace in your life, then that you'll find yourself exiting from that. Now I had many situations today. It was an extraordinary day, as every day is. I prayed for it, and it was. But subtle stuff. I had this huge truck, pickup truck, come up behind me. It was pressuring me. I was going the speed limit, and I said, you know what? I got a big enough vehicle. I'm big too. And I'm not going to be intimidated or pressured by this. I'm just going to stay at the speed limit, and they can't run me off the road. And that funny thing was, is that I just kept going. I looked back, and the truck had turned left off the road. And suddenly it dawned upon me what this was about. Was very profound. I'm an apex yoga now, which and we're going all the way, all the way. Whereas this guy pressuring me wasn't going all the way. He was turning off. He was turning off on a side trip. But he was all like big shoddy, kind of like overcompensating for, because in down within, deep within, he knew that he was not making it all the way. So he had to present this big show to the world in terms of how great, and how powerful he was. Whereas me, I'm just cruising along at the speed limit and just, not making a big deal about it. Because I know I'm going all the way. I know I'm going all the way. But I wasn't intimidated. This is really amazing. I felt this feeling like I can't be pushed around. Like a spiritual feeling. I can't be pushed around spiritually anymore by being an apex yogin. I have this groundedness somehow. A lot of little stuff happened today that was profound. I asked for a sign from Longchenpa, and suddenly I looked at this decal in front of me, and it was kind of like this car, and I said, "What is this? I don't understand what that is. What is, I'm trying to make it out." And then I realized it said HE greater than I. HE a greater than sign I. He is greater than I. I mean, God is greater than doubt. I is just a term we use referring to doubting what we are. As if there's some other self that's not what we are. Like I? Doubt? So he's greater than our problems. God's greater than our problems. Help is greater than our problems. And I'm finding that I can talk when I'm really thinking of something very clearly. I don't. The music is my attention is not on the music at all. It's still there, but I couldn't tell you what the song was I just heard. But then, any instant, I can turn my attention to the music. Beautiful. But then I can go back and turn my tension externally like this to external expression. Now, anyone can do this. The thing about apex yoga is we're very clear about this. Anyone can do that, can drop doubt. We don't need to drop dead, we need to drop doubt. So if you upset with somebody, don't say, hey, drop dead. We say, hey, drop doubt. Drop doubt. They said, no, I'd rather drop dead than drop doubt. Well, no, drop doubt. We've done it, you can do it too. So we need role models to show people, yeah, you can drop doubt. So I've seen these Dharma kings and I say, oh, they dropped doubt. Wow. And they keep telling us, you can do it too. That's why we came, to reassure you. Yes, you can. Now, a little help never hurt, right? I'm listening to the A-team. Ridiculously good. Ridiculously tasteful. Wow. They've got tremolo on the guitar, and they're just strumming it in the perfect, giving the perfect tremolo sound to accompany. It's just amazing how talented they were. Just very much in touch with emotions and how music and emotions are one and, yeah. I used to be that way when I was young. Absolutely. I mean, I was totally in touch with music. Still am, but I don't feel it as strongly as I did when I was young. And I love to, you know, play tremolo. Tremolo is so cool. The tremolo effect. A twin reverb had like reverb and tremolo. Ah, man, I used to love that Fender amplifiers with reverb and tremolo. It sounds so good. Still would sound great. Yeah, really. It still sounds great. Wow. So we're wowing our success. We're wowing the fact we're going for it. Nothing to lose. What, you know, what do we have to lose by going for it right now? We just know. We don't have to talk about the world anymore. We just know it's, you know, people are, it's just hysterical. Panic mode, panic. And the ugliness, the panic stirs up in everyone, right? So, it's like the world has cancer. The world is a cancer right now. So, what do we have to lose by, let's just go for it. So I'm just proving to myself that I can do this. I didn't even consider it up until just before taping. I didn't know what I was going to do. I thought I might sing along or something, but My voice is so terrible right now. I said, no, it's not going to sound good at all. Can't do it. So I said, maybe I should just turn it off. I said, something told me, no, no, no. Just turn it down and let it stay there. So I said, okay. And so this is just, you know, so it's just all the spur of the moment. And it's working for me. I don't have any problem at all with it. People say, I have to doubt. Well, you know, doubt is the label we have for I. So if we don't doubt, the label is meaningless, right? That's all. In fact, doubts just make-believe. So it's already meaningless. It's always been. We're trying to make it meaningful, but it's impossible. Apex yoga. Work out great. Follow great nutrition. Have great nutrition, have great workouts, and have great focus on Apex yoga. Very simple. I was doing a great workout today, which is speed workout, with this something like a cane. Like you have a real, like flexible, real flexible, lightweight cane. And just whipping it through as fast as possible, simulating like a golf swing. That teaches the body to move really fast. So I did a lot of that and was able to see different acceleration of it. Got really high acceleration. And then I'm working on lag, how you kind of go slow like this, and then just at a certain point, suddenly, everything all together goes really fast through. So I'm trying to maximize the speed, the swing speed. So that's like part of workout. Go suddenly, go very rapidly. That's the idea behind hitting a golf ball far. Don't try to swing real fast from the top because you'll use up your speed. You want to get all your speed still collected and ready, and at the last possible moment, let it all go. And that's the lag, it's called. That's where you get the most swing speed. Don't go back real fast. Go back really nice and slow. Like you're in no hurry at all. You're in no hurry. In the top, you kind of lag. And you start to come down. And then it's one moment, you're still here. And the next moment, you're already finished. And it's like, there's like in a flash. It happens just that quick. That's the goal. So I was working on that. The driver I got is, for me, it feels super stable. I love that. The shaft is a 69.5 gram shaft, which is, normal is like about 64. The trend has been to really super light shafts. I got ones like 50 grams or something. It's too light. I don't like it. It doesn't feel stable. The swing weight's not good. The swing weight of the club is, this one is D5, which is slightly heavy swing weight, which is good. It feels strong, feels stable. So you can swing it real fast and it still feels very stable. Excuse me. Bit of a cold, you know, here. But length of the shaft, 45.25, which is slightly longish. I mean, that's the way all shafts are now. Actually, it's less. Most are like 45.5, 45.5. Some go up to 46, 46.5. Sometimes the tailor-made shafts are longer. But in most of the pros, like, use 44. They have much more control. They can still get all the speed out of it. So I choke up on about an inch or so. Gives me like about a 44-inch shaft. So it's the perfect club for me, actually. So I can just swing as hard as I can. It still feels very, very stable. Not whippy at all. And a lot of pros are going to strong, heavier shafts now. They say it's more accurate, and they don't really lose hardly any yardage at all, maybe 2 yards if any. Whereas the trend before was super light shafts. So the idea is to load up, and then you're coming down. Everything just you can feel it. You have to know the moment, the right moment to just let it all go. Just let it all go where you know there's no stopping anything. You're committed. And then, in a flash, it's all, the swing is completed. This is the way to do it, and this is how we need to do it with apex yoga. Apex yoga is this very rapid approach. Very rapid. It's very direct. Where we may have been going very slow, 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 then whew, done. It's done. We've done it. We see, oh, this is a dream. Yeah. We don't need to label exactly what we've done. But we finished. We finished, and we've have a great result. Great result. Very beautiful, gorgeous result. Gorgeous, just like this music I'm listening to is just gorgeous. Just gorgeous. It's just there. So we shift, we just make the quick shift transition into this just gorgeous. This gorgeousness, where the light is reflecting certainty to us, this play of certainty, this gorgeous play of certainty. Ah, the frogs are out. And yeah, you know, it's February, what, 16th today, 17th when you're listening to this. And I mean, spring is just about a month away, right? I mean, we're whole state's just greening up fast here. Blossoms are out all over the place. So it's coming, and summer is coming. I'm pushing this. It's saying, you know, everything's going so fast now. So we have to go fast also here. We have to go fast, but we are. But it's easy, isn't it? I'm having an easy time with this. This beautiful, gentle music's just flowing through my mind, and yet I'm able to keep my thoughts very clear about what I'm saying, sharing here. It's not a problem at all. What an experience. So this is very skillful, this apex yoga, where we are helped by some very great helpers, really top helpers. We have, as I said, two of the best singers have ever lived right here, and some of the best musicians that have ever lived, combining together, along with the background singers, two of the best background singing groups that have ever existed also. And they're all come together here to help us with our apex yoga. So I had the feeling like, you know what? Let me try this. And it's perfect. It's perfect. And we're back to me and Jesus. What a song. Yeah. Ah, gorgeous song. George Jones and Terry Wynette, Me and Jesus. On headphones, earbuds like this. So, and the same with the Beach Boys. Some of the maybe the best harmony sound that's ever in the history of the world, along with LA's, you know, finest studio musicians, the Wrecking Crew in LA, again, some of the best musicians ever, all geniuses. And then the recording studio and the techniques they had, the reverb they had, everything was just, the best. Just all that came together in such an amazing way. And we have that now to help us out. So keep in mind that we can do this. We can get help from those who have left treasures in the world for us to help us out. Now, maybe Padmasambhava has put a term of treasure in my mind stream that will just begin, like a CD beginning to play. And it'll just be some beautiful Vajra dance of Padmasambhava. Something just so sublime and beautiful. And yet, I'll just let it play like the CD. Say, okay, just let it play. And just continue, sharing with others like this. Very possible, actually. The goal is to show everyone you can do it too. Now, of course, if you don't believe, say, prove it, well, you're not an apex yogin there. Apex yogins have faith. They have tremendous faith. I have super faith. I have so much faith, I believe that Padmasambhava could have done that. Wouldn't surprise me one bit. Well, a tiny bit, yeah. It would wow me, for sure. So, the Dharma Kings may have put into my mind stream some gorgeous treasure, some really gorgeous treasure. And they can do the same with you. Absolutely they can. When you are ready to wake up, certainly it's probably there in everyone, actually. We all have some gorgeous mind treasure to help us wake up, like this CD that I'm using right now. But it's all unique to the style of our dreaming, right? It's all unique to the style of our dreaming. So what's important is just to recognize, you know what? It's possible for me. And I need to prepare for that. Excuse me. Runny nose. And you can do it yourself with a CD. So, the apex yogins, do stuff. They actually do stuff like this. They actually say, you know what? Let me try that. They're not like helpless doubters. Wow. So we have so much knowledge here about what's possible. And this great discovery of Tibetan Buddhism that Longchenpa catalyzed for me is, and for us, for apex yogins everywhere, is pay attention. He said, look what's possible. You can have this in your mind stream just waiting there for your faith to activate it. But you have to activate your own treasure within your mind. I mean, you have to experience it for yourself the way that it is. So it's somebody else's treasure is going to be different. And so don't ask, well, you got to describe it to me or represent it to me or something. No, that only get in the way. To some extent, I mean, the sublime, getting used to sublime content is okay. But keep in mind, it's your treasure that you have to hear the song being played within your mind. Experience it. And you'll realize it's beyond words. There's no way I can represent this. There's no way I can represent this. It's too gorgeous. Any attempt to represent it, cast doubt upon it. And the whole idea is that it's freeing you from doubt. It's light casting certainty upon us. So we just trust the light will do this for you, because I gave it permission to do so. So of course it's going to do so. So the jitters have to be worked on without, in a way that doesn't keep getting in our own way. Faith, 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 faith is so important. And it's a path of faith. Set the world free to show us that there's never been a world. Set the world free to show us that there's never been a world. And it will. That Jesus tells us it will. So I have faith in that. Jesus says, let's wait together. He says, let my confidence be your confidence. And let's wait on the light together, shall we? And I use all the Dharma kings. They're all waiting together with us here in confidence. So let their confidence be our confidence. So the thing is the key is that this sublimeness continues on even though we don't try to concretize it. And that's what's the whole point of it. There's never been any concretization, and yet we doubt that. So we're getting used to it's all flowing for us without us trying to concretize it, because we believe that God wants us to concretize God. And that's not true. So we think if we don't try to concretize it, God will get angry at us and stop the music. So you have to have faith. Don't do anything at all. Just enjoy it. Don't try to concretize it. So if I try to concretize it too much, people say, oh, you see, he's doubting that it'll continue. And the only reason why it continues is because he's trying to concretize it and God's pleased. It's like that. So it'll give the wrong impression. Sri Sri Anandamayi Ramaharshi, they never tried to concretize at all, and their bliss remained perfect their whole lives. Well, since Ramana was awakening and Sri Sri Anandamayi was born that way, lotus born, never left her for an instant. So that's pretty powerful evidence right there, isn't it? Very powerful. We could always absurdly imagine something about it, but reason tells us, hey, that's strong evidence, right? All our teaching tells us that, you know, our attempts to define what we are is our doubting that we're pure freedom. But we are pure freedom. And that's how God created us. We're an idea in the mind of God, which is pure freedom itself. So we are pure freedom as well. So there's no definition as to what we are at all. It's impossible. We can never be some concretization. We can never be some process. So as we give up doubt, we've told ourselves so many lies that God created us as doubt. That's a lie. So we believed our own lies so much that we get jittery and afraid when we get ready to, you know, accept the truth of what we are. We think God will get angry, God will punish, but God will withhold, you know, happiness from us. And yet the saints show clearly that this is not so. It takes a lot of work to turn all those lies around, doesn't it? We've told ourselves so many lies, imagining there's some false God that is this God of doubt that will annihilate us if we stop trying to doubt. So we want to concretize whatever arises in our mind. We want to concretize it to avoid, you know, to be safe on the safe side. But of course, as soon as we do that, we lose the true gorgeousness that attracts us, that helps us realize certainty. We lose it. We lose that. The whole purpose of it is to help us realize certainty, that there's only certainty. The truth is absolutely certainly true. So when we err on the safe side in terms of, say, let me try to concretize this, the flow stops and it fades away. I've experienced this many times. I say, why did I do that? Doggone it. Now I have a flow of imagined concretization, but that doesn't really help me get past doubt, does it? Doesn't really solve the familiarity problem, which is we all have. It's still a flow. Even concretization is actually a flow, but it gives the impression of not being a flow. And that then doesn't really evaporate our continuity fear, doesn't overcome this familiarity problem that we have. So it's not really helpful. So just let it flow. Don't try to concretize it. We're not being given this to make a song out of it. Like, okay, wow, that's beautiful. Let me concretize it into a song. You don't see these Dharma kings doing too much of that. Really, right? Did Ramana concretize a whole bunch of paintings and music and artistic stuff? Or Nanda Maima wrote, did she write a bunch of books? And no. They're just here to show us this beautiful, gorgeous flow is there to help us be free of our doubts of concretization, definition. And it doesn't leave us. You know, we're taught like inspiration arises for artists and they need to immediately, you know, oh, I got to concretize this. And if we don't, that inspiration won't come again, that it somehow is a gift from God, that we're supposed to, he's given it to us so we can then concretize it and make heaven on earth by, you know. This is not true. That's the opposite of truth, actually. Real inspiration comes to help us practice not concretizing it. This is reversing the thinking of the world totally. So I've done a lot of practice in this of not concretizing. But being artistic type, you know, I'll do a video of like the ocean and show it, but the flowingness is still there. It's still there, right? But a lot of times, I just let the inspiration just be there, especially the inner visionary experiences. This beautiful dance of light. I've had quite a few experiences of that, and then just let it flow whichever way it wants to flow, and I don't get up. In the past, I would have gotten up out of bed and said, oh my gosh, I'm going to compose like 5 songs out of this. Or I'm going to like do a painting or a drawing or a poem or something. But I don't do that anymore. So that's a huge, huge, huge advance. It's very difficult because you think I could be a famous, great artist. I mean, unbelievable inspiration I'm getting here. Yeah, I could be like the greatest artist the world's ever known if I somehow capture this, catch an image of it. But the whole idea is to don't capture it. Don't try to capture an image of it. That's the whole purpose. So the spiritual purpose is quite different than the purpose of artistry, being a great artist. And as I said in a previous life, I was a great artist. I've already been a great artist. So for me, I'm not so tempted to do that. I don't really want to do that again. If you haven't already done it, I could say it might be almost overwhelmingly tempting because you think, oh my gosh, this is more beautiful than anything there's in the world at all. So if I could somehow give an image to that, people would just say, oh wow, how creative you are, how amazing you are. But that's really shortchanging everyone. We need to take the long-term viewpoint and realize that's not really what it's for. Because the flow of inner vision that we see is so sublime, so gorgeous, that the images we see in the world are like nothing. It's the difference between an image of water and actually drinking the water. Okay, you can't even compare, right? I mean, comparing is absurdity. So, what the example we need to set is to not make so much artistry out of it, really, and to just be in the flow of it, experience it, and let others see that it's easy to do. You can do it also. That's the real goal here. That's the reward that will never be satisfied with mere images or mere artistry. No way. No way. Not possible. Because all of that is just doubt. Trying to have happy doubt? Not possible. The conflict is still there. We have to experience our mind functioning the way God created it to function and get comfortable with that. And that certainly is not fixating on images and believing in doubt and concretization and definition. That's not how we were created to function at all. Now, so it's a very, very difficult thing to get out of being a creative artist because everybody expects it. They'll keep feeding them fish instead of teaching them how to fish, right? So I've had a devil of a time just making this transition. I just. Because if you feed people beautiful imagery, they think, oh, you're so great. You're giving us fish. You're feeding us. Oh, boy, you're just so wonderful. You're so wonderful. But if you say, hey, I'm here to teach you how to fish, oh, they don't want anything to do with you. So you go from being very popular to everyone just ignoring you. It's very, very, very difficult. And you want to keep thinking, gee, if I just, did something. Give them a fish, they'd say, oh, thank you for feeding me with something nice. Because they're insisting that, well, they can't get that inspiration. They just, can't, no, I, God doesn't love me like that. Yeah. And, but if you teach someone to fish, you feed them for a lifetime, right? So they then can have direct access to the gorgeousness of it all. And only that will satisfy them. So if you give them fish, they're never satisfied. And they keep demanding, they say, yeah, well, where's the next fish? Right? And you feel trapped by it, that you're like a slave to their demands. Really, the consumer enslaves the producer. It's terrible. It's terrible. But so few are willing to learn how to fish. It's difficult. I've had a difficult time at it. And don't try to remember the gorgeousness of what you're experiencing. Just wow it. That's our practice. Apex yoga practice is full stop in the wow. Wow. From wow to wow to wow to wow to wow. As soon as you try to remember, you're trying to turn into an image, concrete image, to then present to the world. What's important is to present to the world that it's still going on. It's ongoing. Hasn't stopped. Now, when I looked at Sri Sri Nanda Mahima, I always, like in the videos, I always said, when's it going to stop? I was looking very carefully to say, is it stopping? I remember that. What I really wanted to see is, okay, how long could she keep this up? And then I saw that it's effortless and it's not stopping at all. I was so stunned by that. It's like she's not doing some meditation to generate something. It's just naturally flowing continuously. And she's oblivious to any effort or worry, concern that it might stop. And it never stopped. It never stopped. And that's apex yoga. And this is the approach we're on. We're not trying to generate anything through meditation. The apex yoga is the path of perfect non-meditation. We've set all meditation free. Here. Set all your meditation free. And now to and it returns as a beautiful dance of light to delight you into a feeling of certainty, familiarity with a feeling of certainty that doubt was just a dream and had no effect on what we are, had no effect. Just trust the light, trust it. When the Holy Spirit, when we free the light, free all meditation, free the world, free all meditation, the Holy Spirit tells the light, okay, light. The Holy Spirit speaks for us then and tells the light, light, present this gorgeous dance to help us get used to familiar with certainty. So the Holy Spirit's really what we truly are. Excuse me. So it's not like we'll have this abyss, like not knowing what. Well, the Holy Spirit knows exactly, and the light obeys us perfectly. So the Holy Spirit is really what we are. What we are, Son of God, an idea in the mind of God. And so it will instruct the light and say, "Tell the light, light. Okay, I want you to now present this gorgeous play of light that just is in the now, in the moment, constantly." I had an acquaintance, one of the world's great painters of all time, and unfortunately he had a bad ending, came to a bad end. And I was knew him during that time when he was just it was killing him. He just said, "I can't take this anymore," because he was trying to convey to people the inner beauty, the beauty of the inner landscape. But the inner landscape is beyond conveyance, and it just, he was like giving people fish, and they were becoming, dependent upon him. He's really famous, really wealthy. That's not the way. As astonishingly beautiful as his paintings were and his talent was, I was fortunate enough to come across some some I had an inner I had an inside access to see just how extraordinary it was. I saw the last painting he was working on before passed away. It was unfinished. It was still there. The easel was there. His paints were there. Everything was still there. And it was so beautiful. But it doesn't even touch the beauty of the inner experiencing, really. It doesn't. It, like I said, it's like an image of water compared to actual water that you can drink. You can't really drink an image, can you? Not really. Because doubt's there. Doubt is the consumer of images. So we must battle against this, like trying to ask, can't you just do like a painting for me or something? It's our job to not request that. That's so an apex yogin doesn't request such make such requests, and they realize that I have to experience it for myself. That's what being a yogin is. Apex yogin is commitment to experiencing it for ourselves without getting hooked on images, imagery about it. So I believe God wants me to go in that direction of away from the imagery, all the work on imagery I've did. I've tried to present, some of the most sublime, very, very sublime imagery to at least give us a faint, faint, faint echo. But unless we really practice with the apex yoga practice, the wow, wowing it, our experiencing. It won't arise for us, but it will just be a few glimpses in our lifetime. That's not good enough. We're not after a few glimpses. I've already had many, many glimpses in my life. I'm not interested in glimpses. I'm interested in continuously, abidance, a continuous. And everyone should be realize that's the goal. This lifetime, make it this goal for your lifetime. And it's difficult. Our wrong habits keep going back to fixation, and it's frustrating. But I believe I have faith is possible. I've been told that I have this inner faith, very strong faith is possible, and I can do it, and you can do it as well. If I can do it, anyone can do it. I'm as much a knucklehead as anybody, and really, those who want you to give them a fish, when you don't give them a fish, they'll leave. They leave and go look for someone else. That's a fact. Absolutely a fact. Now, occasionally there are those who produce some very sublime work here in the world, and it can give us a faint echo or something. It's like an image could give us, doesn't really give us what it's about, but deep down we kind of makes us feel like, you know what? I want the real thing. This is nice, but I want the real thing. Yeah, occasionally some artists come in and do something. But there's already been so many, why do we need more, right? What we do is we avoid spiritual practice, which is the essential component of it all. Like Jesus says in the Course of Miracles, hey, time to go beyond the words of the Course, okay? Don't make this into just another book to read, okay? And I don't intend it as that. And I stop in 1993. I closed the Course of Miracles. I said, okay, I'm done with it. I've done my thing. Really, almost 20 years. 20 years starting. No, not 20. Quite 20 years. About 15 years, actually, of just complete immersion, constant complete immersion. But then I felt like Jesus wants me to go beyond that. That was 1994. Started in 78. So that's, it's about 15, 16, 17 years if you count 78 and 94. Then 1 year with Journey Beyond Words, and then I just said, okay, let me work my way towards what the real goal is here, and it's not the words of the Course. So that's been since 95, 20, 22 years of doing that. So it hasn't been easy. You struggle for 22 years or something. We're very nervous about it. Very jittery. The jitters die slowly. They die down slowly. But we don't find that out until we try. Really. We can just keep saying, "Ah, give me a better fish to eat, Give me a better book." I could have just said, "Okay, great. Give me a better book." But after Journey Beyond Words, I said, "Forget it. Yeah, that's good enough. This is just fabulous." It's not about just, okay, what's the next book? What's the next book? What's the next book? At some point you say, look, it's not, I have to really do what the book has told me to do. And I've got a problem with continuity fear. I got a severe problem here. So I have to really practice getting past these jitters. But that's a pretty small price to pay, isn't it? For constant gorgeousness. Aren't we going to spend our time in some way anyway? I'm going to spend those 22 years in some way. I might as well spend them preparing for eternal gorgeousness. That's a super investment, right? Super great way to use time. Or these moments we refer to as time. Now, faith is important because if you don't believe you can do it, you think you're wasting your time. For me, I said, I know I can do it. I know I will do it. Eventually, we all will, eventually, yeah. But the patience, the waiting, and the patience is just, it's just extraordinary. Every day for me is a waiting game, a patient waiting game. And just saying, okay, what's the next jitters I need to look at and make less? So I'm always looking to, how can I make the jitters less? So God's really blocking everything now that goes towards some sort of creativity, of expression, pretty much everything. And that means that the real thing is on its way. The flow, the dance. And the key is to heal our mind of the continuity fear. That's the goal. So I have to practice that healing for myself, or I'll be an unhealed healer. That's not helpful, actually. The helpfulness of Ramana was because he was Ramana. His mind was, it was without doubt. That's the effectiveness of it. Not because he wrote a bunch of books or did all this creative work. No, because he was certain. There's all sorts of creative work, like on Facebook, you see it. Imagery, right? Yeah. But how many are there that are abiding in certainty in the world right now? Right? Because without that, all this imagery just generates more doubt, okay? But if you really have faith and you're practicing, then imagery can be have a little bit of helpfulness to you. But if you don't really have the push, it's actually can just keep generating more doubt, thinking that imagery is what we were created to do. Right? Not so. So eating great workouts, great yoga, apex yoga practice. This is where it's really at right now. So like God said, skip to 217 and be ready for 218, because everyone's going to need certainty in 218, some kind of certainty. All right. They may be imaged out, just say, wow, this doesn't work for me. God blessed me with bad eyesight, so that I would get burned out, and I decided not to do it anymore. 'Cause I can't stare at the screen anymore. My eyes are almost blind. I'm almost blind in my right eye, and I just can't keep doing it. I'd like to. I mean, I love doing it, but God's just telling me, giving this infirmity, so I can't really do it. I remember one instance of this inner imagery, or image, inner flow, this dance of light that I experienced in this place. I went to this really beautiful, gorgeous place and stayed there overnight. I was staying there, maybe stayed there a couple nights. As I went lay down to go to sleep, suddenly the inner imagery was just flowing with all this beautiful foliage and trees and plants and beautifulness. And what happened was, no, actually, I came home. I came home from that place here, and I went to sleep the first night home, and that's when it happened, I believe. I believe that's when it happened. And it was just gorgeous, just beyond belief, gorgeous. This dance of the light presented to me. You have to train your mind. Don't try to structure it. Don't label it. Don't name anything. I don't name anything that arises, really. Don't name it. Don't try to structure it in any way. Just experience the vividness of the colors, the beautiful play of colors, the play of form as it morphs and shifts, and the beauty of it. Just sheer enjoy the beauty of it. Don't try to say, "Oh, gee, what's the name of that plant there?" Don't do any of that. That's why you have to go into the right mind in this abstract mind. You have to train yourself to accept abstraction. And most are so caught up in naming, they block it instantly. They're terrified of it. They think they're losing their mind. Just the opposite. They're gaining confidence in their mind. But we've been trying to lose our mind for so long that when we start to regain confidence, that we think we're losing our mind. We think losing our mind is our mind. To have lost our mind, we think is reality. And to regain confidence in our mind, we believe that's insanity. That's losing our mind. They're going crazy. So these poor souls have it backwards. And you try to introduce anything abstract to them, and they immediately try to concretize it. Oh, you're having beautiful imagery. Oh, what are the names? What do you see in the names? And what kind of colors? Name the colors. Name the forms. Name this. Name. Label it. Label. 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 Categorize it. Structure it. What came first? What came second? And they try to put all these definitions and structure into it. And of course, that just grinds it all to a halt. Concretize it. Turns it into a piece of concrete. They're terrified of it. How sad, how pathetic. So, but you have to train your mind to not do that. Because really, everything is everything. In other words, what you're seeing, what you're experiencing, is that everything's everything. You see a leaf, but you're experiencing that leaf can be anything else the next instant. Everything you see can be anything else the very next instant. There's no limitations. There's no lack of freedom anywhere in your experiencing. So to put structure, labels, and definition is completely contrary to the whole purpose of it. Sir Rama says, just be quiet. Just be quiet. He's talking about the non-abstract mind. Just stay in your abstract mind. Abstractness. Don't the part the mind that labels, defines, structures, categorizes, remembers, all this stuff. Just let that mind be quiet. Let that activity of mind be quiet. That's doubting what we are. That's how we doubt what we are. All is all. All is all. If you want to describe abstraction, what you experience, just say all is all. All is all. And you're experiencing that. All is all. That's God, that's reality. All is all. So how can you say that this is a leaf? Define it. Now, all is all. Always. All is all, always. Now, again, this, we've been introduced to this, Apex Yoga introduces us to the possibility that there's a time for us to, for this experiencing, gorgeous experiencing to begin, like a mind treasure. That, I mean, when I had a dream of Ananda my Ma, before I became aware of her, I had a dream. And then I went to a bookstore the next day and stumbled across her and ran into video the next day. But before that, I had a dream. And it was just, I was in a gold mine, and I'd been prospecting my whole life. And I found little nuggets here, little nuggets there, and I was just really, you know, experienced and intense prospector. But I never, you know, could come across too much treasure. But I thought I had come across some treasure. I had some little nuggets here and there. And then I saw this little piece of gold in the wall and began digging into it. And as I pulled the dirt away and rock away from it, it kept going. It was this gold. And the more I excavated, it didn't stop. And ultimately, I finally came away with this boulder. Like, I mean, it's like 3 feet in diameter, kind of, right? A nugget 3 feet in diameter of solid, perfect, pure gold, radiating this golden light. And I was just absolutely overwhelmed by it. And I knew that something extraordinary had happened. And then the next day, I went to a bookstore, and I saw three different instances of this person. I didn't know who it was. And each time, I didn't know who it was. Who's that? And then suddenly, I realized, wait a minute, it's all the same person here. I better pay attention who this is. Let me find out something about this person. It was Sri Sri Ananda my Ma. And so I had dreamed of her the night before, of coming across her treasure. You know, so it was somehow my mind stream, it had been set up to come across this treasure in this lifetime. And I did. And I try not to think of her too much because it's overwhelming. Really. The most overwhelming expression here I've ever come across. And she overwhelmed even the gurus and the yogis and everyone. Everyone she met, she just overwhelmed them. It's just, wow. That's all you can say is just, wow. So, these mind treasures, you're meant to come across them. When you come across them, you realize you're meant to come across them. So what's the next treasure that I'm going to come across? I don't know. So the light takes all these images that we have imagined and begins to dance with them and make them better than an image. Makes them come alive, as it were. And starts flowing. And so it doesn't take the imagery away from us, but it just starts making it so sublime and gorgeous. The images become like living images to us. I mean, just listening to this music here. I mean, take a modern day musician. They could never do this music. There's no way. The restraint is so sublime. The gentleness, the tastefulness is, they couldn't do it. They couldn't even come close to it. Not really. So on our way back to God, we need some help by these this mind treasure that we come across, really, that it's just because we're so crude and crass in being concretized into this imagery that we just don't, we don't have that beautiful, gorgeous flowingness. So getting some help is very helpful. I mean, I don't even think I could do this music, you know, now. It's just, it's too, the sensibilities are too restrained, so beautifully restrained as part of the culture. It's amazing. No hurry. No one's in any hurry at all. There's a sort of a confidence in Jesus that's reflected in this music. They feel like we're saved. We're not in a hurry. We're happy. We're happy with the Lord. We've repented, and we know we're saved. And so, it's that feeling that permeates the music. That in the modern day age right now, you don't get even remotely close to this feeling. No, nothing even like night and day. All the players is just so minimal, so minimal. Because the gorgeousness is there, you know, in their hearts, that they realize that this is just helping trigger their faith. The music is just designed to trigger the faith in Jesus and salvation from doubt. And so, it's minimalist. And it's going slow, no hurry. Wow, faith-based music. How much more faith does the light have in the Holy Spirit? As it presents its play to us, right? Perfect faith in us. So as this inner imagery, as this inner flow with imagery, as you have this experience, this is the faith that God has in us that we're experiencing. We have to say, wow, look at the faith that God has in us, you know, perfect faith in us, no doubt in us at all, right? And this is what we start to experience in a little way, gentle way, like a gentle breeze. And this will happen. I've seen it's ordained to happen. So we need to have an apex yogin culture. And those, you know, who are apex yogins, we need to put this culture out. So we're not interfered with by fearful, greedy ones who say, oh, just give me an image of it. I want to I'll make so much money out of this. So just give me a little bit of help here. I want to make a lot of money. You know, that's not what it's about at all. And they might be very angry that we don't do that for them. But that's the big mistake. Let your own inspiration guide you. You all have treasure within your mind. The Holy Spirit has not left any of us without the treasure to remind us of the certainty of God in us. We're an idea in the mind of God. God is absolutely certain about all ideas that God has. So we need to be reminded of this certainty that we most certainly are an idea in the mind of God, and God has no doubt about us at all. We have not been able to get God to doubt us at all. So the gentle reminder begins, gentle flow, gentle breeze, little breeze. And, well, I could go on and on, couldn't I? Yeah, all right. But probably I better go in, and I'm going to get too chilled out here with this cold or whatever it is. And the music continues. Wow, what a blessing. I got a CD player because I have all these wonderful CDs of this music. And so I don't have MP3s of them. And I don't want to spend all the time trying to rip MP3s out of them, burning discs and all that stuff. I just buy a CD player. I have all these beautiful CDs. It's great. Beautiful sound. Frogs giving its beautiful sound to this. So, just accept yourself as an apex yogin if you have this restraint within you. And say, I'm going to learn how to fish. I'm going to discover that mind treasure that's within me. The Holy Spirit gives us to all of us. And I'm going to go in that direction. That's apex yoga. So set all your spiritual practice, your meditation, set it all free so this play of light can come back to you. The Holy Spirit sends it back to you. No abyss for you. The Holy Spirit sends it back to you. And you become one who's experiencing the gorgeous certainty, and then you're, you know, helping, being a savior to those in doubt, still having this continuity fear about doubt, having a bias against certainty. You become like a savior, helping them from that awful ocean of samsara, of doubt, the ocean of doubt, the horrible ocean of doubt. Having been through all the storms in that ocean, it's so truly terrifying and horrible. It's hell, it's agony. So help save, give confidence to all, certainty to all those who are still adrift on this horrible ocean of doubt. And let's have apex yoga and culture here start to blossom, start to bloom here. Yes, we can. We can do it. Absolutely. We will do it. If God's will it is that we'll do it, it will happen. Okay. Very great. That's it for this one.